a CEO and a CFO are talking. And the CFO says to the CEO, what happens if we bring in this coach, we bring in this trainer, we bring in this program, we educate our people, and then they leave us? Total waste of money. We invest in them and then they go. The CEO turns back and he says, well, what if we don't invest in them and they stay? If you think about it, now really is the right time for a leadership conversation. At the very beginning of the pandemic, we were all about crisis management. How are we going to get through today? As time went on and things eased up a little bit, we started to maintain things. And we asked, how are we going to get through the week? This week, next week, we started having the ability to look further ahead. And finally, as we get to the recovery stage, which is where we are now, we can start to think about the future. We could start to think about, again, building our businesses, rebuilding them. And if you're familiar with something called Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which in effect says that we cannot engage in anything really meaningful and purposeful if our fundamental physical needs are not attended to. So imagine a teacher on a fast day trying to reach a class of students who are fasting, right? If they are hungry, if we are thirsty, if we don't know where our next dollar is going to come from, if we don't feel physically safe because there's a pandemic raging in the world around us, we don't have the bandwidth, we don't have the capacity to think about the higher order things. We don't have the ability to think about our future, about the things we really want to accomplish in this world because we're in survival mode. There just isn't enough time to do what I need to do. I am extremely busy. I mean all of us. We're extremely busy people. We have tremendous responsibilities. We talked about some of them before. Got to manage a facility, got to manage a variety of things. Tons of people that report to me. Lots of things that need to happen. And ultimately, I don't want to just be a manager. I want to be a leader. And there is a difference between the two. In the words of Stephen Covey, management is efficiency in climbing the ladder of success. Leadership determines whether the ladder is leaning against the right wall. Leadership is all about the vision. Leadership is about implementing new things. Leadership is about changing the culture, changing things that are core and central to the way that your business runs. But who has time for that? Who has the ability to think bigger, to think different when we're putting out fires all the time? So if we learn how to manage our time better, we will have the wherewithal to do some of these other pieces. I believe at its core, if we can focus on three I's, we will go a long way in helping to solve these challenges. The first I is integrity. The second I is influence. And the third I is impact. Okay, integrity, influence, and impact. Integrity is all about being the very best version of myself that I can be, communicating clearly what I stand for. Influence allows us to direct and strengthen the work of others because we're influencing them. And impact ultimately is your bottom line. Real successful business people understand people. Real successful business people understand, how do I motivate my people? How do I get them focused on what's really important? And how do I get them to take action so that they are productive, they are fully engaged, and they are working with me to advance what we're trying to accomplish? It's really all about your people. Let's talk for a moment about integrity. When it comes to integrity, we make promises and we keep them. We're neat and we're organized physically as well as mentally. We're centered and we operate from a position of control. We are honest in our words, in the words that we use and how we express them. We listen carefully to others and we really try to understand. And finally, we seek people's well-being and we demonstrate a feeling of empathy. Because fundamentally, we can build a stronger team when we lead with integrity. I think it is absolutely critical nowadays, more so than ever, to try to become a really good listener. A really good listener. And being a good listener means not just that my ears are focused on the person, my body is focused on the person, my eyes are focused on the person. I'm listening to hear and to understand. And I demonstrate that by reflecting back to you what you said to me. When a person is a good listener, people feel validated And that alone is important and worth the emphasis that we just shared. A man's walking down the road and he sees a cathedral is being built alongside the road, a big, massive structure. And he walks over to the first bricklayer and he says to him, "Sir, what are you doing?" And he says, "I'm laying bricks." Continues a little bit further down the road, finds the second person. He says, "Sir, what are you doing?" And he says, "I'm putting up a wall." Finally gets to the third bricklayer yet further down the road. And he says, "Sir, what are you doing?" And he says, "I am building a cathedral." So the first person was all about the money. I'm laying bricks. I'm doing my job. I'm here. I have a job. I'm doing my job. It doesn't matter what I'm doing. I'm laying bricks because that's what I was told to do. The second one is starting to connect it a little bit. He's starting to put the pieces together and he sees he's doing more than just laying bricks. He's building a wall. But it's only the third one who's able to see beyond. It's only the third one who could see the totality of what's coming, what's happening. I am building a cathedral. And everybody here who is making a contribution, whether you're running a facility or making a contribution, maybe you're selling to facilities, whatever you do, you are ultimately helping end users who are your patients, end users who are people who need your services. And you have to remember all the time, that is part of what you do. That motivates us. When things are difficult and we're struggling and our numbers are not what they need to be, and we're concerned about other things that may be beyond our control, minimally we have to remind ourselves, why am I here? What am I here to accomplish? Who needs what it is that we provide? Highly underrated, highly underutilized, and almost free, handwritten notes. A handwritten note is so powerful. I will tell you, I almost got like writer's cramp 10 times over. 1 year, I really wanted to work on teacher morale. I really wanted to work on my relationships with teachers. This is when I was the head of school. And so I wrote a letter to every member of the faculty. The letter was exactly the same for every single one. "Dear so-and-so, I'm looking forward to a great year with you," whatever that was. I had one sentence on every single card that was unique. And the sentence was, "I really appreciate fill in the blank." I chose one thing. It could be the way that they taught something. It could be the way that they were a team player at meetings. It could be the way they went above and beyond. It doesn't matter. Everybody was different. One thing. And then when I'm sitting with my faculty support committee later on that year, and I'm talking about different things that were happening, one woman says to me, "I've got that card. I keep it right above my desk, and I refer to it all the time." You have no idea how powerful a single handwritten note is. High in the Himalayan mountains lived a wise old man. Every so often, he ventured down into the nearby village to entertain the locals with his special knowledge and talents. One of his skills was to use psychic powers to tell the villagers the contents in their pockets, boxes, or minds. A few young boys from the village decided to play a joke on the wise old man and discredit his special abilities. One boy decided that he would capture a bird and hide it in his hands. He knew, that, of course, that the wise old man would know that the object in his hand was a bird. The boy came up with a plan. He would ask the old man if the bird was dead or alive. If the wise man said the bird was alive, the boy would crush the bird in his hands and kill it. If the wise man said that the bird was dead, the boy would open up his hands and let the bird fly free. In this way, the boy would prove the old man to be a fraud. The following week, the wise old man came down from the mountain into the village. The boy quickly caught a bird and, cupping it out of sight in his hands, he walked up to the old man and he said, "Old man, what do I have in my hands?" The wise old man said, "You have a bird." And he was right. The boy then asked, "Old man, tell me, is the bird alive or dead?" The wise old man looked at the boy and said, "The bird is as you choose it. The bird is as you choose it." This is the essence of your leadership journey, everyone. The path that you take and the ultimate destiny are in your hands. The question is, what will you do with the opportunity? Thank you very much.